great. Hey, Kenny Randall, stop talking and come up and open us up, brother.
You gotta wait on you.
Pardon? That's exactly right. You're smart. You didn't figure that out.
That's one way to stop me. All right.
They
got it already.
They got it?
How y'all doing today?
All right.
All is well? Huh? God brought you here safe and sound? Did you come here to give him a little glory while you're here in the place? I didn't get an agreement on that one.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. I got an amen corner right next to me.
Amen.
Bless the name. I was thinking about this place. Actually, I was sharing this a couple of weeks ago, someone about how I first started coming to these meetings. And I just thank God for them. Just thank God. Let me just go to the Lord in prayer while we're here. Can we do that? Father, we do thank you today. Lord, we honor you, Lord God, because you're God. And beside you, there is none other God. Father, we thank you that, Lord God, how your spirit, Lord God, has been present in all these years, God, in these meetings. God, I thank you that you brought people from near and far, God, from highways and byways, people from all walks, Lord God, of life, all, Lord, situations and, God, circumstances, Lord, but more so you brought souls into the kingdom. So, Father, we thank you, Lord God, that someone is here today, God, that really needs to hear a word from you. This, Lord God, they didn't come to hear a man. They come to get a word. We thank you, Father, right now that you would move, God, through the midst of your people, God, those who have sickness, illness, disease, circumstances, situations. I pray you release your healing balm right now, God, through the praise and worship that's getting ready to go forth. That people would be healed, delivered, set free by the power of the word of God and by your praise, God. We thank you right now today. We give you the glory, the honor, and the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And now the meeting is dismissed. I love to hear that brother pray because he had some practice, hadn't he? Well, let's say the bill, we're going to get you to come up. But let me just say this to you. This morning, I got a very simple word that I want to share with you that will help you to change how you look at life. It's a very simple word. Faith begins when you come to your end. As long as you can figure it out, you don't need faith. But when you come to the end of your ability to evaluate or to try to understand, and then you believe, even though you can't see no way that this could possibly work out, because faith is the substance of things hoped for but yet not seen. Amen. The moment you give your hope up, your faith quit working. So one thing Satan wants to do is to discourage you to give up hope. When you come to that place and you don't have no place else to go, and you're at the end of yourself, that's when you need to bring your praise on. Praise you, Lord, that I can't go no further. Praise you, Lord, I have no understanding, but I'm trusting you because I know there's nothing I'm going through that's greater than you. Come on, Bill. Don't get nervous, Al. I'm not going to keep going.
Boy, what a blessing. What a blessing it is to see you, Marcia.
Yeah.
This morning, I'd like to start with Isaiah 55, verse 1. Come all you who are thirsty, come to the waters. And you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why spend money on what is not bread, and your labor on what does not satisfy? Listen, listen to me, and eat what is good, and you will delight in the richest of fare. Give ear and come to me, listen, that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, my faithful love promised to David. I'm going to skip verse 6-9. This is Isaiah 55 again. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord, and he will have mercy on them. And to our God, for he will freely pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. Praise God for his word.
Come on, Ronnie Mays. Come on.
Ready?
Go, Ronnie Mays.
2, 3, 4, and...
Come to this fountain, yeah. So I have a longtime friend of mine here. We literally met about 10 minutes ago. This is Joy and her husband Rod over here, and she comes highly recommended by Billy. Where's Billy? She was just here a minute ago. But anyway, Joy's going to sing for us now. There's power. In A, yeah. Sing a little bit and then we'll get the groove.
There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. What you done for me. I say, Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. Jesus, I'll never forget how you brought me out. I say, Jesus, I'll never forget. No, never. Come on, Jesus, I'll never forget what you done for me. I say, Jesus, I'll never forget how you set me free. You brought me out. And I said, Jesus,
Thank you, Lord. What a great surprise. Thank you, Joy. And how about a hand for Rod for bringing her out here today?
Golly, Bill, you about to grow an afro, man. Golly. Wow, Brad, I know you got excited, didn't you? I thought you were going to fly away, man. God almighty. Well, Junior, what you think? Well, look, we're going to have a word, and we're going to get her to do another number before she leaves today. Also, I just want to acknowledge, this is Clay Jr., this is Clay's son. You remember we had his going home service last Friday, and Clay was a regular here. We're going to miss him, but Junior came down today, and we'll get him come back today and share, but I'm just glad he came. Get a Lord a hand clap, amen? Amen, amen, amen. We got a good brother here that's going to bring us a word. He called and told me. He said, Brother John, I've got a word. Mike, you're in charge. If this is not from God, I want you to get the rocks and start with that, brother, okay? Are you ready, Mike? Come on up, Mike Norton. Amen. Get the Lord a hand clap. Amen. Amen.
Wow. Well, we pray that the Holy Spirit would anoint this meeting. He's done it. And he's going to continue. And I have got to share a word that God had given me that has given me great encouragement in these troubled times. And you've heard the old saying that some of you have awakened this morning and said, Good morning, God. And some of you have woken up and say, good God, morning. And it all depends on our perspective. And if you are as old as I am, 68 or older, you have stepped in it one more and many more times than others. But I guarantee you, God is with you in your stepping. And when we talk about walking with the Lord, that means we're moving. And that is key. And I want to share some things that will be that was really help to me, because some of us, in fact, I've heard some people say, you know, as soon as we are born, we spend the rest of our life trying to get over it. And that is the epitaph, or some people's dash. And so I would like to, you know, when we have had troubles and tribs, it's always good to check with someone who is an expert, someone who's experienced what we've experienced. And one of the greatest experts that we know of is David. David. He has a psalm for every experience and every trial. When we get up to heaven and we sit down and have not a cup of coffee, probably a glass of wine. When we are talking to to David and we tell him what we have gone through, he'll say, you know, I've been there, done that. Oh, I've been there too. And I've done, oh, yes, I've been there and I really done that. And so we cannot outdo David. And that's why he is so, so excited about God's grace. And so we're going to look at Psalm 34. If you have your Bibles with you, it's amazing that some people will bring a Bible to a Bible study. But before I go into the text, I would like to give you a little bit of a background of what brought him to write this incredible, incredible psalm. You see, for years, David was was running from Saul. Saul wanted to kill him. He was after him for many, many years. Now, many of y'all probably haven't had someone really after you or chasing you, except maybe creditors. But Saul was a bad actor, and David was afraid, understandably. And what happened was it came a day that it was really amazing. He runs in to see the priest, and you know how priests are. Oh, you look distressed, son. What can I do for you? And David says, oh, do you have a sword? I left my sword in my other pants. Oh, and he wasn't thinking of that. And it's like, kind of like going into your church office and say, hey, pastor, do you have a gun? Well, in Texas, we'll say, oh, well, do you want a Glock, a 45, 30, 38, or what kind of ammo do you need? But this was sort of unusual. And the priest said, well, the only sword we got is under that ephod over there. It's Goliath's sword. David just lit up. Oh, wow. Goliath's sword. Ooh, that's a good sword. Give it to me. And then he got that sword, and he did something really unusual. He runs to the enemy camp and hides with the Philistines. Now, that was probably pretty good wisdom, except David had a problem. He was carrying Goliath's sword. That is like a neon light. Here I am. Come and catch me if you can. And they did. They captured him, and they were taking him to the king, King Achish. That's in 1 Samuel 21. And it was really, really hilarious. While they were carrying him along, I could just imagine what he was thinking. You know, this day is not going well, because he was going to be toast. Well, when he got there before the king, he not only had a sword, he had a Sharpie. And he started acting like a madman, and he started scribbling all over the town gate, and he started letting saliva dribble down his beard. You know, now to think about this. This is the man who wrote what we call wisdom literature. And so he was going just crazy, and he's just a scribbling, dribbling, and the king is sitting there looking at this. And so the king decided to make a statement. Now, gentlemen, do I lack madmen in this here kingdom of mine that you got to bring this man to me? And they're standing there kind of like, oh, that was terrible, and embarrassed. And my daughter always had a word for a moment like this. Awkward. And so they were so embarrassed, they let him go. They let him go. And so he runs across some pretty rough terrain, and he comes to this cave called Adullam. Don't you love a name like that? Cave Adullam. And he gets there in that cave, and his heart is a-pounding, and the Holy Spirit is pounding on his heart. He had no chance but to write this incredible, incredible psalm, Psalm 34. And let's take a look at it, see what he wants to share with us as wisdom in these troubled times when we step in it. He says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. No let up. My soul shall make its boast in the Lord. Now, this is what we call in the Hithbael stem, which means he's not going to boast in himself. He is going to boast in what the Lord has done. So that's the kind of boasting you can do. So that's okay. And it says, the humble shall hear it and rejoice. They will be encouraged. They say, hey, that could be me. I could assimilate that too. Oh, magnify the Lord with me. And let us exalt his name together. The key is with me and together. He called a meeting like this. He doesn't want to sit under a tree somewhere by himself and praise the Lord. He wants to have fellowship. He wants to have support from all his brethren so they can praise the Lord together like we were doing. And then he said, I sought the Lord. He's saying this because he's emulating the fact is, hey, if you don't have a testimony to talk about, let me tell you about what happened to me. He said, I sought the Lord. Now, this word sought is not like, you know, because God, the Lord was lost. You know, where are you, Lord? That's the Lord's role. Where are you, Adam? Okay. And he sought the Lord. That word is seeking the Lord through prayer or studying his word. We want to pray and study his word. He sought the Lord and he answered me. And he delivered me from all my fears. And those fears are intense fears. In other words, to the point of terror. He was terrified. And then he says, skip down to verse 6. He says, this poor man, referring to himself, this poor pitiful man cried, and the Lord heard him and saved him from out of all his troubles. Now, this is interesting. I was looking up, trying to understand, is there some real meat in this word heard? Well, I looked up in the Hebrew, and the word was Shemiah. And Shemiah, of course, means hear. But then it dawned on me on another psalm I was reading where it was talking about obey. I looked up obey to see what that word was, and it was Shemiah. Wait a minute. Shemiah means obey. Shemiah means heard. In other words, the Hebrews didn't have any concept of just hearing with your ears and not doing anything. Their understanding, if you hear something, you get your rear in gear. Okay, you do something. It's another word for I, sir, I've already got a plan. I am doing something. Like the Lord says, even before you finish your prayer, I'm working on it. All righty? That is so encouraging. And he got that same encouragement. Remember, and a good example of that is when President Bush was standing at Ground Zero, and he was talking, those firemen were hollering everything, and he says, with his megaphone, he says, I hear you. Obviously, he could hear them, but what he was telling them, I have got a plan, I'm going to do something about it. That is the way God works with our prayers. I hear you. And I'm doing something. And so he takes on that as an incredible encouragement. And then in verse 8 he says, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. How blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. You got to taste him before you can see it. You got to experience the Lord before you can see what he can do. And that, it assimilate the Lord. Identify with the Lord. Take him on, and then you'll see what he can do. And then he says, oh, fear the Lord, you his saints, for to those who fear him, there is no want. Even the young lions, they'll roar and cry, and they suffer hunger. But they who seek the Lord shall not be in want of any good thing. Then he says, come on, you children, listen to me. I will teach you how to fear the Lord. Really? Yes. And so he explains to them, he says, first of all, watch your tongue and watch your lips, watch what you talk about, and depart from evil and do good, keep peace and pursue it. In other words, he wants us to put shoe leather on our prayers. He wants us, like I said, to walk in motion. He wants us to be a living a life that will emulate holiness. Then he says, the eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears are open to their cry. Now, that word righteous, that doesn't mean we're good. In other words, he declares us righteous. When we have accepted Christ as our Savior, he imputes his righteousness on us, because in Isaiah it says your righteousness ain't no good. All right? It ain't no good. In other words, he declares us righteous. I mean, you can be as bad as Smokey and me, and he's going to declare you righteous. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. And it's just awesome. Yes, it's incredible. And so we are righteous because we're putting on his righteousness. And then he says his eyes and his ears are open to the righteous cry. But the reason I brought out this righteous, I wanted to make a statement, is that this is for us who know Christ as Savior. For those who have not known him as your Savior yet in this room, this will not really apply to you very much, but he's going to have some things here for you too. So hold tight. He's not going to leave you out. But for right now, he's going to talk to us that know him. And he says he is attentive to our cry. And I said, cry? I said, that's some strange. So I looked up cry, and that word is Shabba. And Shabba is a cry for help. It's not a, it is a cry for help. Lord, help me. And that is what he is attentive to. And then you jump down to verse 17, and we expect something like that. He's going to respond to us for our cry for help. You expect a psalm to say that. But then it looks like he's repeated in verse 17. He says, and the righteous cry, and the Lord hears, and he delivers them out of all their troubles. And I'm sitting there, well, I guess that's nice that he repeated that, but he just said that. And of course, at my age, it's probably really, really helpful, and because I can forget what he said from one sentence to the next. But I looked that word cry up, and it was a different cry. I said, whoa, this is not the cry for help. It's tziak, which means a boo-hoo cry. In other words, when you are concentrating on your distress and your predicament, God still hears you. There's nothing wrong for crying over what you assess what you're in. Well, be honest. Cry. God has created your tears, so use them. In fact, in a companion psalm, in Psalm 56, he says that he holds stores our tears in a bottle. Now, for a lot of us, of course, he needs a jug. But a jug just doesn't sound very poetic. So he makes it really nice sounding. He holds it in a bottle. Okay? And so we cry. It's nothing wrong with that. You know, we look to the Lord for help, but then we also see what we're in, and we cry, and we understand, and he is there promising he is still going to take care of you. And then he surprises us in the next verse. He says, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. Brokenhearted and crushed in spirit. What that means is there are some of us that are cried out. Our bottle is already full. We can't give any more. We are just crushed. We are brokenhearted. We are in a stupor. We cannot believe this is happening. In other words, we are suffering from what we call waiting for the fourth watch. Remember when the disciples were scared of their life? They thought they were going to drown. And Jesus came by, and very, very pointedly said, he came at the fourth watch. Not the first, not the second, not the third. He waited until the fourth watch. Come on, Lord. You're finally here? Oh, yeah, I'm here right on time. Because many times the Lord wants us to experience this enough so we can learn everything that we need to learn, and so we don't forget what we have learned. Sometimes it takes a little time, but it is burned in our heart, and we will never forget it. So a lot of times he waits until the fourth watch, not necessarily the first watch. And so just because it takes time for him to come and rescue you, don't put him on a stopwatch and say, oh, well, you're not answering me. Be patient, because God may be doing other things. It's not all about you. He may be, you may be on a display for somebody else, and they're watching you, how you respond, and their life is being transformed because of how you respond to what God has done and why he waited on the fourth watch. So sometimes praise God for the fourth watch, but also praise God big time when he pulls you out of it and he does finally rescue you. And he says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Now, in verse 15 and 18, he talks about our physical rescue when we are in trouble and how he rescues us. But in 19 and 22, he talks about our spiritual rescue. And he says something very interesting, because in verse 16, you know, this every verse in this psalm is starts in the Hebrew with a letter in the Hebrew alphabet, so you can remember it and you can memorize it in the Hebrew, okay? But you can remember it because it starts with the next letter, like in the alphabet of the Hebrew alphabet. And so 16 starts with this Hebrew letter, faith, okay? Well, in 22, he ran out of letters, and he repeats it, faith, okay? Well, that must be a reason for that. And I looked at that, and in verse 16, he says, the face of the Lord is against evildoers, and cut the memory from them from the earth. But then on contrast, in verse 22, he says, the Lord redeems the soul of his servants, and none of those who take refuge in him will be condemned. In direct opposite. So he tells what he's going to do for those who do not come to him for salvation. And he also says what he's going to do for us who have come to that acceptance of his salvation. And so that is a great, great promise for all of us. And if you have not come to know the Lord as your Savior, of course, now is a time of salvation. But I want you to remember this huge statement, that Jesus loved you so much that he would rather die than live without you. And so he did. He died. What more evidence would you want or do you need to demonstrate his love? Well, that is not a rhetorical statement, because a rhetorical question is never answered. But he answers this question. He says, oh, you do need some more evidence. So he had Christ rise from the dead to new life, so he can give you new life. And now you have enough evidence to put your trust in the Lord. And I pray that you do, because you can experience rescue after rescue after rescue of what God does for the righteous, because you will be considered righteous in his eyes because you're clothed in Christ and his righteousness. And then you can be free to enjoy serving the Lord in a maximum way. And life is an adventure. We all have a designer life that he has put together according to Psalm 139, that is, before there was a day in your life, it was written in a book. Everyone has a book written about you. And he has designed your life for his glory and his purpose. And you can dread it, or you can enjoy it to the max. And I pray that you will enjoy it to the max, because there are 7,000 promises in the scripture for the righteous. And we will not live long enough and study long enough to remember all of them and to study all of them. And that's why when he brings his kingdom on earth, he is going to give us 1,000 years so we can review it in our own time. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your incredible love, your loyal love and your attentiveness to each one of us. And Lord, we ask that you, by the power of your Holy Spirit, will give us the wisdom to walk in a way to put a smile on your face. We want you to be so pleased with our life, and we cannot do it without your help. So, Lord, visit each one of us. Show us things that you're doing personally in our life so we can praise your name for it and thank you for it, and not just praise the God of good fortune, but it's you who took care of us, and we need your help, your Holy Spirit, to help us continually trust you and trust you and trust you our whole life. Thank you, Lord. We love you. Amen.
Tell you, man, that was awesome, wasn't it? Give the Lord one more time a hand clap, God. Amen. 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 I believe your wife was going to do another number for us. Come on up, dear. And Bill, did you want to sing with her?
Tomorrow?
Okay, all right. I don't want to. Come on up, dear.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Isn't the Lord good? Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. He's an awesome God.
Yes, he is.
Amen. Glory to God. Amen. I don't know what you come expecting the Lord to do for you today, but I believe that the church is everywhere we go. Amen. He is inside of us. So no matter if you're in a barbecue joint, amen, I love barbecue joints. Amen. No matter where you're out on the street, on your job, he is where we are. And we are where he is. Hallelujah. I thank God for that. We can have heaven on earth. Amen. I believe that we are the light of the world. And wherever we go, we should be shining his light. Amen. Praise God. This song simply says there's power in the name of Jesus. There is power in name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, 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 break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, 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 break every chain. There's an arm. You are the army today, amen. There's an army rising up. Glory to your name, God. There's an army rising up. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Come on, there's an army rising up. I see, I feel it rising. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up.
chain, break every chain, break every chain, to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Can you say this? I hear the chains falling. I hear the chains. I hear the chains falling. I hear the chains. The chains falling. Every chain, everything that's binding us. I hear the chains.
I need to hear you, come on. I need to hear you without the music. There is power in the name of Jesus. Oh, I feel it. There is power in the name of Jesus. Oh, somebody's beginning to feel it right now. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break it again, break it, come on, break it again, break every chain of sickness, break every, of disease, break of mental anguish, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, break every chain, hallelujah. Give the Lord a sweet praise offering in this place. Hallelujah. He's an awesome God. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Smokey, for inviting us today. We appreciate the God in him. Isn't he a godly man? We had so much fun with him. We didn't even want to leave last Tuesday. Amen.
Well, Bill, I think we have another candidate for our musical. How many of you all was here when we had the first musical on Saturday night? Raise your hand. All right. We're going to have another musical pretty soon. And we're going to have a really time of celebrating. And this young lady also has some CDs if you want to get one. You do have CDs, right? And so if you all would like to get a CD, you may get one. How much are your CDs? $10. $10. And let me just say this to you. I don't know about you, but as she was singing, I believe somebody in here today had a spiritual healing to go in your body. And if you're going through something right now that's in your body, why don't you just acknowledge that you believe there's power in the name of Jesus. And in that name, you believe whatever it is that you're going through, you can be set free. It's amazing how this whole meeting is gone. We started off talking about faith starts where you end. You can't have faith as long as you can kind of figure out how to do it. Faith is when you tried everything you possibly can try and you don't have any more answers. But for some reason, deep down inside, you believe that you can still accomplish that you believe. Because you're now not operating in your strength, but you're operating in his strength. And nothing is impossible with him. Nothing is impossible with him. But you can't know that till you get to a point that you don't have no place else to go. As long as you can kind of hang on to something you think you can do, then you're not going to understand what I'm talking about. But when you get to that point, there's no other place that you can go. And all of a sudden you say, you know, Lord, I've gone as far as I can. You know, I learned that from my granddad. My granddad was a farmer. And my granddad would sit on the porch and he'd plant seeds and he would fertilize and get through. And all of a sudden, I'd hear him on his knees. He would say, God, this is Bud, your son down here on earth. God, I went to the bank and borrowed money from Bradfield to buy seeds to plant the crop. I plowed, I fertilized, I planted, but unless you bring rain, me and your name both gonna be mud at that bank. And he would get up and get on the porch and he'd get that big old blower and he started singing one of those Negro hymns. It wouldn't be long before we saw rain. Because he knew his God. He never went to seminary. He didn't have no theology. But he had a relationship with his God. See, a lot of us know a lot of word, but we hadn't taken that word to where the word become a part of our life. See, when you get that word down in you and you digest that word stands when everything else is gone. And the thing is, Lord, I remember. See, that's what we need to do is we need to create some I remember into our subconscious awareness so that when we're in that situation, we can go back and remind ourselves that he was faithful over here. He's going to be faithful right here, and he'll be faithful over there because he's the same today, yesterday, and forever. He doesn't change. He does change you in the midst of circumstance. Cool. Yes, Mike. Yes, ask for prayer? Okay. What? Okay. Call out loud then if you want prayer for your niece. Okay. All right. Okay. 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 Wayne Mitchell, would you come up and lead us in a prayer? Let me just acknowledge somebody. Paul Taylor has a young lady here that's a doctor. Stand up, darling. She's given many Bibles to China. She's a doctor, and I didn't have time to get on the program. So what I want to do is let you know if you'll come back, we will pray about it, and we'll probably let you share something about what God's been doing in your life. Amen? You look at the smile on her face. I think she might know Jesus. Amen? Give the Lord another hand clap. Amen. Wait a minute, brother. You're like you dragging. I don't want no dragging prayer warrior up here. If you're that tired, go sit back down and go to sleep.
Before we pray, we want to thank God for this one. Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Now, you know, last Tuesday, Sister Girl said, hey, I'm having some chest pains. And somebody said, call 911. She left here in one of those red vehicles. And they kept her overnight.
Yeah.
And she did have some problems, some spiking sugar or something. But God. And so as we pray for your niece and your son and your nephew, there's nothing like knowing that God is going to do something even before we say it.
Amen.
See, that's what faith is. You don't have to wait and see it.
Come on, bro.
faith is evidentiary. I mean, I know God is going to do something because I know who he is and I know who I am in relationship to him. So that's why we pray. And your daddy is sitting right there. Hallelujah. Jim Williams is in this room. Jim Williams had some problems. Amen. A couple of months ago, Jim Williams was laying up in the hospital. Paul Taylor lost his life on an operation table 3 or 4 times. Seven times.
Oh my God.
They took 14 inches of my colon out last year. Told me I needed a chemo. Y'all know I had cancer. I don't have cancer now. God answers prayers. And there's anybody in this room, you know, raise your hand if God did it for you.
Amen.
Because if you are here today, he healed you. You were sick one day.
Amen.
Yeah, we want to pray for your wife. See, people are grieving. People are hurting. Tell me what's going on, baby.
She said, come here.
We're going to pray, y'all. But listen, prayer is not the magic. God is the healer. God protects. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to pray because we know who he is. So why don't you reach out, grab somebody's hand. Grab somebody's hand. Smokey got something he want to say before we get going.
Our faith is not in our prayer.
Absolutely.
Our faith is in our God that we're praying to.
Yes.
Make sure we keep that straight.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Clay, because you are here, and you told me you're not going to be a stranger.
Yeah.
Amen, brother.
Amen.
We know you're grieving, and we know why. And so we want to remember that family, too.
Of Clay's family as
we pray. Absolutely.
And you all remember this. When you're praying, lift up the Smith family.
Yes.
You know, Junior's here today. He's got a sister, Ann, his mom,
statement.
And 5 grandkids. Bubby?
Can I just say, because the word that Smokey spoke just so grabbed me. There was a statement someone said years ago. The faith that fizzles before the finish is a fizzling faith. But we do not have a fizzling faith. He said, the faith that fizzles before the finish has a fatal flaw from the first. My answer to that, I shared it with Dr. Ford. The faith that's fixed on that firm foundation, which is Jesus, neither fiend nor foe can fracture. That's the faith we have.
Amen.
And I love that. That's,
amen.
You know, but a faith that hasn't been tested can't be trusted.
Amen.
So if God is testing you, he's good.
Amen.
He will pass the test, not you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's pray. Father, we listen. We've heard stories. We've seen that you, God, move in ways that we can't understand. You do things that we can't explain. We can't even describe.
Yes.
Because, God, you are beyond description. You are inscrutable. Your word is absolutely beyond our full comprehension. But you said, Lord, you will speak to us.
Yes.
And so right now, God, by faith, we believe that you're going to help Mike's daughter. You're going to help his niece. You're going to help his son. You're going to send them in traveling mercies where they need to go. You're going to help the Smith family, Lord. We pray for Carol right now, for Annie, Lord. We know that Clay Bob is here. God, we thank you, God, that Clay Jr. is sitting in this room because even as he said goodbye to his daddy and he's going to sprinkle ashes on a lake, that man is where he wanted to be.
That's right.
In your presence.
Thank you, Lord.
So death is the answer to a whole lot of this deliverance, God. Because you can deliver in death just like you can deliver in life.
Yes.
And we thank you for the life that you are giving. For the life that you gave to my sister Marcia as she was last week. We didn't know what the situation was, but you did.
Yes.
She's standing here playing and singing, God, because you are a healer. We see Bill sitting in the room, Lord. We thank you, God. We thank you, God, that Bill Williams is here. We thank you, God, that there's people in this room who need you, God, because surgery is coming. Doctors are going to invade. They're going to do invasive things, God, in people's bodies. But, God, you know that you are the healer. You don't need doctors. You use them for your glory.
Yes, Lord. Yes.
And so, God, we praise you.
Thank
and we receive even in ourselves right now the healing that we all need. We receive right now, God, the comfort that we all need. We receive right now the answer to prayers that we've been praying in secret. But God, you hear in secret and you reward openly. God, we know that faith, without it, it's impossible to please you. By faith, everything that pleases you happens. By faith, everything that is miraculous happens. By faith, we trust you, God, because it's evidence, it's substance. It's things we can hold on to when we can't see. And we praise you, God, because it's enough. You say your grace is enough for whatever we're going through. We thank you for this meeting. We thank you for this gathering. This congregation will never be convened again like it is today. So we thank you for the presence of everybody you sent.
Yes, Lord.
Your spirit in everybody. Do what you do through us, God, as we go out these doors. Greet somebody. Give them a holy hug and a kiss. Let them know you're glad they came.
Yes, Lord.
Don't take for granted any face that you see. They may not be here next week. Praise you, Jesus. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, brother. Give the Lord a hand clap. Amen. Now, let me tell you something. There's not a lot of places you can go have lunch and get filled twice, spiritually and physically. Now, if you've been filled spiritually, you already know you feel physically. Go let somebody know you've been filled spiritually. Be blessed. Greet somebody before you leave. Amen. Huh? Oh, what? Amen. Hey, make sure y'all give her some good Holy Spirit loving before she leaves, all right? And make sure you do the same for the doctor before she leaves, all right? Be blessed now. Huh? Hey.